You really have to know Edie to be able to understand this whole venture that she goes on.
Her parents, you know, really did ditch her.
She had a damaged childhood. This, you know, all came out anecdotally when her brothers died by their own hand.
I'm the only surviving son, and Edie was my baby sister, one I truly loved. My father, Fuzzy, was an artist, sculptor, and an oil man.
She was afraid of her family, of her father in particular.
Anybody who reads about Fuzzy, about what that father was, God, he was, two of his sons committed suicide, the wife ran away and became insane, the daughter died of ODs.
Life magazine came one time to take pictures of the family because we were eight children living on a ranch, all had horses. And these pictures that were taken were absolutely wonderful pictures and showed the family as this harmonious, wonderful unit. But in actuality, but this was rather phony.
She had an awful relationship with her family. And what existed between she and her father.
It's been suggested by some people that there was some indiscretion by my father. I don't know. I never heard of it. She never told me about it. But others have suggested it. And that could be the problem she had with connecting with the man.
The mother was in and out of the booby hatch. The mother put Edie in and out of the booby hatch.
It was sort of the Sedgwick way.
When we did things which didn't really fit in with what the parents, quote, said we should be or do, it seems like we were either sent to an asylum or banned from the ranch.
You think about the ranch on which she grew up. There were three of them, the last one in Santa Barbara. And there was this wide expanse. It went from horizon to horizon. And yet, she comes to New York, and what does she do but find herself in the factory, which was very closely confined. It was a tight little world, free of her parents' influence. Her father had dictated everything that happened in her life and controlled, really, who she was. And now, finally, in the factory, she could be whoever she wanted to be.
She liked to shock high society, particularly as they were represented by her parents.
You've got to look at the background. You've got to look where she comes from.
And we came from a prominent old American family. In fact, we had a sign of the Declaration of Independence.
From a great railroad family.
An oil baron.
Politicians.
Aristocratic.
Early Speaker of the House.
President of Southern Pacific.
And distinguished lawyers.
We also had somebody that started New York.
Centuries of breeding, fine schools, culture.
Very proper New England society.
In Edie's crowd were the best and the brightest and the richest of Cambridge. Old-fashioned Cambridge, which means Harvard and or Radcliffe.
I can't imagine her wealthy Bostonian-y.
She was more known for her quirkiness, her prettiness, and her charm. There was a great flow in the early 60s between Cambridge, you know, undergraduate society and New York underground society, which was beginning to pick its own stars and had picked, Andy Warhol was one of them.
Here was a guy from Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania, who came, was the youngest of three boys. He'd grown up in abject poverty.
He had a disease called St. Vitus Dance, which caused his skin to have problems the rest of his life. He spent most of his time indoors, huddled around comic books.
Went to New York, became a very successful commercial artist very quickly.
But that was an aspect of himself that he wanted to shed. He wanted to reinvent himself and start fresh.
At the time, artists like Lichtenstein, these pop artists who were, you know, making comic frame panels into glorious pieces of art that were selling at auction at fairly high prices, and where pop art was, you know, sort of becoming the talk of the town, Warhol was basically saying to himself, I can do this, you know, I can do it better.
1964, very early.
Edie one day decided she was going to venture down to New York and told me before she went that she was become the greatest star in New York.
She came down from Cambridge with Danny Fields.
Tommy Goodwin, her big brother sort.
Danny Lyons. See, they were the elite, right?
Tommy said, Edie here, she needs a place to stay. Of course, she was a beautiful girl with, sure enough, a Shetland sweater and a gold circle pin. I mean, I don't remember if it was a plaid pleated skirt, but I can't, I mean, I saw enough to know what I was seeing.
You sure you'll be okay in New York?
I'll be fine. Actually, it's not that easy.
When you unhitch a disastrously damaged and beautiful thing from its perhaps loathsome moorings and send her out into the world, she's at great peril.
Edie came from Boston. She was wanted to make a splash in New York, and she spent a great deal of money picking up the bill for parties that she gave.
The money flowed like water. Did that caught up with her in the end?
I don't know how Edie and Andy found each other, the perfect kind of couple of the times.
Andy and I first met Edie at a party at Lester Persky's penthouse.
At the 50 Most Beautiful People's party.
Which was where she had a cast on, and she danced on a table.
It was quite a party.
Now, working out for Edie then was this wonderful dancing that she did.
She's dancing on a table very precariously, and we had our heart in our throats.
She was terrific. All her moves, and she was uninhibited.
Oh, wow, she's so beautiful.
And Andy was very struck by her.
And she just danced her way into everything.
I believe that that's where Andy met Edie.
Andy would always invite somebody to say, oh, would you want to be in one of my movies? And of course, Edie took Andy very seriously on that and thought this was her meal ticket. But he probably thought it was his meal ticket, too.
What initially drew them to one another was the potential of the benefit of each other's fame. They were a perfect match for each other. They worked on it, they fed on it, and it worked.
What do you think of the factory? Do you like it here?
It was on East 47th Street, not far from the United Nations. It had actually been an old hat factory. Warhol moved into it, I believe, around 1963 and began painting his silk screens there. And it simply took on the name The Factory because it had literally been a hat factory.
Andy was attracted to
the quirky people, the off-center people.
People that were on the fringe or on the edge in a certain way.
It was a very artistically expressive group of people.
We were just crazy, mixed up kids on drugs.
A lot of people thought we were nuts. We magnetized towards each other because we were so insecure. We all needed each other. To me, it seemed like a collaboration of artists and dancers and painters and writers and musicians and models and busboys and Blondie.
He surrounded himself with the most beautiful, clever, outrageous, and entertaining cast of people whom he lived with.
He enjoyed the liveliness of those people around him.
Every moment was entertaining in one sense or another.
You know, the factory created its own stars.
Billy Name came to live in the space, and Andy invited him to paint the space silver, and he was really the factory manager.
Bridget Berlin, who had what she called her cockbook. She would love to have people draw, or she would illustrate their genitalia in her book.
Chuck Wine was Edie's
chaperone,
confidant.
He was good looking, he came from a good background, he was Harvard. He was the person that Edie relied upon to protect her, make sure she got home.
People like Ondine, who was this crazy speed freak, this roaring, fabulous, colorful queen.
Gerard Malanga was essential to Andy's image. He was very good looking. He worked very hard and very talentedly at Andy's, not only his artwork, but at his image. Gerard instinctively knew what to do to make Andy look better. Gerard and Edie clicked beautifully.
She was someone that you could hang out with. You know, you could take her anywhere and say, let's go hang out and have a drink at the bar or whatever.
His kind of accent and streetwise behavior was a perfect contrast to her aristocratic aloofness.
This was her alternate family.
Andy Warhol represented a safe zone for Edie.
Edie saw Andy as a liberating substitute for her father.
So there was a certain kind of symbiotic relationship between Andy and Edie.
As a man, as a homosexual man who had been pressured by his mother to be a heterosexual his whole life, found potential in Edie, both as sort of a version of himself that he could never be, wealthy, sophisticated, but also Edie's able to introduce Andy to her high society friends, people who can afford to buy art.
To elevate him to a much more respectable and serious level whereby he would be getting a lot of attention from the press.
Edie wanted more than her 15 minutes. And she was prepared to work for it 24 times 7.
Andy recognized a superstar when he saw one.
I just think what you're doing right now is so glamorous.
There's always a girl of a time zone. And as London had their Twiggy, we had our Edie.
Edie had a singular style which was her own and nobody else's, and her ability to express herself in a totally original way that no one had ever thought of doing.
No bra, the new pantyhose, the new I'll sit and stand any old way I want.
And people thought that was so daring, and yet she could be society's darling.
It's almost that Andy offered her a new world to express herself.
And she was beautiful.
Drop dead.
Stop a man dead in his tracks.
Beautiful. She was alluring. She was attractive.
She was a mesmerizing presence.
That wonderful face.
Almost like perfection. She was perfection.
She had a look.
What she wore.
Clothes, the attitude, the dance.
How she moved.
Long, long legs, her high heels, that great body that she had.
How she made up.
Double set of eyelashes. And those huge eyes of hers. My God, her eyes were like teacups.
How she accessorized.
And the glasses perched on top of the head.
She was a great model. God, she lived for the camera. And the camera really, really lived for her.
Some say she was trying to look like Audrey Hepburn. I think she looked like herself, and I thought she was divine.
No, Edie's a superstar.
The press had a field day with being able to create stories around this combo of Andy and Edie.
One of my first exhibitions was to have Andy Warhol have his first retrospective.
You and I both know that you are never giving up hate. Wow. You have just been saying that to get publicity. Well, guess what?
Well, it worked.
I had anticipated a large group of people, perhaps because I sent out 6,000 invitations to a gallery which could hold about 400. I also had the forethought to take down all the pictures for the opening night because I knew that the press didn't know what to say about the art, but they'd certainly know what to say about the no art. And it was a mob scene. This opening created so much of a sensation, and the mob that came to see art that wasn't there, the people who were curious about the superstar Edie Sedgwick and the much publicized Andy Warhol wanted something. They wanted an event. Unfortunately, planning was such that we arrived fashionably late and the place was jammed with this mob and they rushed us. So we, upon entering the museum, we saw a kind of a fire escape, and I got them to this fire escape, and there we were trapped in a fire escape with 4,000 to 6,000 people all screaming for blood at this point. Edie had a dress which had sleeves that went down beyond her fingers to extend about 5 or 8 feet, I think. And as we were above the crowd, she would take the sleeve and unravel it and entice the crowd to more and more excitement because they would jump for the sleeve and they could have pulled her off the balcony. But she continued to play this cat and mouse game, which caused even more excitement. And of course, the press was eating it up and the television cameras were rolling and the lights were getting hotter. And Andy was in a state of faint. He was dead white, whiter than usual. I managed to get some guards to open up the trap door at the top and we escaped over the roof. We escaped down the fire escape and into patrol cars.
No one could have imitated that. Only she could have done that. She invented herself.
She was not only the main event, she was the only event.
Her ability to transform herself into the most glamorous person that anyone had seen that year, overnight, was her own invention. She never even asked for advice. She knew exactly what to do.
She becomes this iconic underground superstar in the factory.
But it was never clear exactly what she did. She simply was herself.
In other words, she becomes, in a sense, one of Andy's pieces of art, a living piece of art. She's the first performance artist of her time. In fact, she may be the first performance artist.
Edie's life in New York was one insatiable orgy of publicity.
Andy supposedly coined the phrase famous for 15 minutes after Edie. She didn't get the love she wanted as a child. She wanted fame and attention. And, you know, it becomes almost this vicious cycle. You know, once you get a little bit of it, you just want more and more. And I think she really blossomed upon it. You know, she really flowered. She really understood what a celebrity was all about, even if it was only for 15 minutes. She was going to seize that moment and take advantage of it, because I think deep down inside, she suffered so much, she hurt so much. So in a way, the celebrity was a kind of medication to sort of numb that pain. And you know, once you start the medication, you can't stop. You just want more and more.
All of a sudden, Andy had a superstar, an actress, or someone he considered to be an actress, which would be the focal point for the movies he was about to make.
Well, you might have to start paying me.
Andy's films had no beginning and no end. He just thought that capturing time on film was sufficient enough and interesting enough to not warrant a script. And actually, he was right.
Andy Warhol's impact on the art world was that it literally turned the art world upside down.
Many critics will say the second half of the 20th century belongs to Andy Warhol, that he really is the patriarch of postmodernism. He was able to take simple objects and make them iconic. He was able to basically deconstruct the core foundation of civilization by taking things that were completely mundane and showing them as beautiful art objects. Postmodernism sort of reached its zenith with Warhol in the mid to late 1960s.
But here they say your work is superficial, that you wouldn't be where you are without Edie.
Oh, well, I don't pay attention to what they write. I just measure it in inches.
I think Edie was instrumental in his success, but I think Andy would have had his own success regardless.
I think Andy's relationship with Edie, I think Andy used Edie from the moment that he met her.
Edie was vulnerable to anyone who can impart a star stamp on her.
Well, I think everybody wants to be famous.
I do think that Edie had and developed a great, great affection. And if you can call that love for Andy, he probably was the love of her life.
She felt that this thing with Andy was something that was just not gonna last.
Andy Warhol was destined to be famous. Whom he used along the way was irrelevant. She was used, we were all used. He didn't pay back.
I think Andy adored her. I really do, for a time.
Eventually, the relationship, which was working so well for them, began to fade and fall apart because Edie couldn't get what she wanted out of Andy.
It was pointless to be in love with Andy Warhol anymore because it was clear it was never going to be a physical affair.
And I think she took a lot of drugs because of it.
Edie, by the end of 65, had begun to fall apart.
I think that when she started to slip into drugs, that clearly that caused a serious deterioration in the relationship with Andy Warhol. And I think that he was in some way disillusioned, and in another way that he felt that this was just too frustrating.
You know, emotional need, okay, to be famous, that's really okay. That's what we all want, to be beautiful, yeah, that's okay. But the drugs, it's not okay.
You know, she used to show up maybe 7.5 hours late for a shoot. She would just have to always have one more poke before she went out the door, and couldn't understand why that bitch was annoyed with her for walking in 6 hours late.
She became a pest.
She lifted things.
She was basically honest. At the same time, she was a mischievous troublemaker, and I think she liked to clip things.
Oh, yes, right. She did steal from me.
She assumed that everything was hers. There wasn't really that boundary that people who grow up in more normal circumstances come to feel.
A person so exquisite with shoplifted makeup.
She had already gone through a couple of trust funds, and now she was put on a very strict allowance.
She couldn't buy friends anymore.
Put everybody on my tab.
She couldn't buy Billy and Undine and those people, because those people were living on the speed.
All she knew was, A, she was in the papers all the time for being so glamorous and wonderful, and B, she was going nowhere and not getting paid.
She was kind of hard-strung for cash, and it seemed that Andy was getting a lot of publicity on the movies that she appeared in, and she felt that Andy should start paying her for the work that she was doing.
You see, the artist steals the girl's stories, makes a fortune, and the girl doesn't get anything.
They used her in a sense. She would pour love out, and they'd shine on it and have parties on it and do drugs on it, and Edie would be drained, and she'd go back to her room and take a pill to sleep now because she was so dead. So I feel that she just didn't feel really loved. Nobody returned the love that she was giving out.
So she turned increasingly to other people rather than Andy.
Edie met a fellow, we'll call him Billy Quinn. He was a wonderful folk singer.
She rushed to associate with another star.
Edie was a magnet to the camera, and I think she found in Quinn an even larger audience of cameras to play for.
And he represented something Edie wanted, feelings that she didn't get with Andy Warhol. The complete package with the spiritual and the sexual in one.
The relationship that she had with Quinn was the breaking point, or the beginning of the breaking point, between Edie and Andy.
Well, Edie was attracted to that world because of the promises they made to her.
The Woodstock crowd whispering in her ear, we can make you a star, we can make you a star. And Andy whispering in the other ear, you are a superstar, you are a superstar.
Billy Quinn represented love and sex for her.
It becomes this kind of crazy, weird love triangle where you have Edie caught between these two worlds. One is this sort of fey pop art world, and the other is this very masculine, sort of organic, you know, rock and roll world. And she gets torn between both of them, and those two worlds go at war, in essence, over her.
We had a meeting in a restaurant. Andy, Edie, the Velvet Underground was present. Andy was pleading with her, saying, oh, you have to be patient. We're not really making any money on the movies right now, which is true. So Edie went and made a phone call, and when she came back, she announced that she was leaving Andy, and she was going over to work with Quinn.
You think I can't function without you? I'll be fucking fine.
And if that intrigues her, who's going to blame her for pointing herself in the direction of those people who tell her that? Because these people, the Warhol people who told her that before, never delivered. But she's the star of what? Beauty Number Two with Gino Pizzurkio? God rest his soul.
And so she just got up and left from the dinner table in the restaurant and left. And Andy was actually stunned by all this.
She played these little games to get Andy's attention.
Maybe he felt that she was making a mistake by leaving, but he was pretty much focused in what he was doing, so it really didn't affect him.
I think people have missed the point about Edie. Edie came from high society. She liked to shock high society, particularly as they were represented by her parents. I think her attraction to the folk singer was that he actually represented the underbelly of society. He talked about it, he came from it, he was it. This may have been one of the reasons why Edie was attracted to your character, Quinn.
She wanted to be loved.
He seemed to complete her. Told me she was totally in love with him.
But I don't know how much she really did love anyone else. It would seem that Quinn wrote quite a few of his most famous songs about Edie.
You know, they were both very interesting, hip, slick, and cool kids at that time. And so they ran together for a bit. It just didn't work out.
One of Edie's flaws was that she was vulnerable.
Vulnerable to all kinds of bad things that can happen to people in New York when they're young and beautiful.
She dealt with the ravages of speed.
If Edie had only asked for help, somebody, anybody, could have helped her. But she wouldn't ask for help. She wouldn't acknowledge that she needed it.
Because she never wanted to be saved.
I want to die.
But it's not as if people didn't try to save Edie. My father, at one point, did try and help her out. After that fire in the Chelsea Hotel, she was hideously burned. And he came to her in the hospital and asked her if he could do anything for her. And she said, yeah, get me my makeup. And then gave a long list of the things that she wanted from the drugstore. And he got them all. And then she took the makeup. And while she was right there in the bed in front of him, painted her around her eyes till they were black. It was like a death's head, he said.
Andy was a non-participant in almost everything, and so he would be the last person to interfere in anyone, including Edie's decision to do what she decided to do. He observed it, probably inwardly grieved but wouldn't show it, but did nothing to try and change the direction.
It's just easier being detached.
In 1968, Edie finally left New York for the last time, and she went to Santa Barbara. And her father, alarmed by her behavior, put her in a hospital there, in a psychiatric hospital. And when she was there, she met a young man, much younger than her, I think just 20 or 21, named Michael Post. And the two of them married.
When we were at the wedding, I'd brought a friend up from England, and he's sitting in the little chair in the hallway. He was looking at her palm, and she was looking at her palm. And then right afterwards, they looked at each other. There seemed to be some sort of understanding. Now, he showed me what he was pointing out. Her lifeline ended halfway down into it, just ended on both hands. And I think that was a moment when Edie really did understand that her life would be short.
Finally, the end came in 1971.
I was in Arizona, and she came to visit with Michael. And I said to her, you know, Edie, I'm so glad you're alive, I'm so glad you're married, and I'm so glad you're so happy, because she really was happy, and she wasn't doing drugs at that particular moment. She looked at me with this wonderful feeling in her eyes, and then I said, but I thought you would never make it. And it was as if glass had been broken, her eyes fractured into, and that made me realize that she was, her strength, in a way, came from my belief in her. So I'd broken that valuable core in her, and then, what, 2 weeks later or something, she was dead.
Yeah, just really sad. You know, Edie flowered as a strange, precious flower in the 60s, and we didn't take care of the flower enough somehow.
I did care about her. I did care about her.